Hey Vincent, I don't know that I can tell you exactly how I got to where I am now as far as my worldview. I think the best thing I could do would I'll show you the books that I've got on my desk and that I've read over the course of the last few months. That'll give you some idea of the sorts of ideas that I'm putting into my head. I will say before I do that though that Blavatsky or I haven't read any Blavatsky. I haven't read the work of any Theosophist, though the closest I've come to that would be Rudolf Steiner, who was a Theosophist, but he left that group and started Anthroposophy, which was his I guess a Christian mystical practice of sorts, is how I would describe Steiner. But let me show you what I've got here. Let's see. I've been reading a little Kant's Critique of Judgment. He talks in here about how we can't understand biology without some sort of teleology, though of course Kant was saying that it's only our judgment, which requires some sort of purpose, in order to understand organisms. It wasn't that the organisms themselves were purposeful, it was that we can't understand them unless we attribute purposes to them. So yeah, it's Critique of Judgment. I've been reading some of the letters of the German poet Rainer Maria Rilke, another one of his stories of God, which is a series of short stories he wrote after he visited Russia. He was inspired by the simple religiosity of the peasant people there. I just got this book in the mail from Professor Anton, Corey Anton. He's a assistant professor of communication at Grand Valley State University. And about 50 pages into this, selfhood and authenticity. There's a lot in here about, well, it's basically taking a phenomenological approach to selfhood, and it's drawing from Husserl and Merleau-Ponty and Heidegger. Really enjoying it so far. I'm gonna make some videos about that in the next few days. Been reading this, Meditations on the Tarot: A Journey into Christian Hermeticism. The fellow that wrote this was published anonymously, but the fellow who wrote it was closely linked to the teachings of Rudolf Steiner. So there's that. Been reading this, The Dream of the Earth by Thomas Berry. I've read his other book. He's got several other books, but The Great Work is the only other book of his that I've read, and I'm just getting started with this one. Thomas Berry actually passed away June 1st, I believe, in I think North Carolina. So he's an ecologist. They call him a geologian, or he referred to himself as a geologian. He was a priest, Catholic priest, but he became more involved with indigenous spiritual traditions and was really more of an ecologist than a theologian, hence, or he was more concerned with the earth than with heaven in a way, hence the name geologian. I've been working my way through some of Plato's dialogues. I'm not that far into it. I'll finish that this summer, I hope. Got some more books over here. Let's see. These are books that I've been reading over the last few months for class and whatnot. Yeah, that's the Bible. The An Outline of Esoteric Science by Steiner. The Lacanian Subject Between Language and Jouissance by Bruce Fink. Jacques Lacan was a French psychoanalyst who developed Freud's ideas in a direction that you may find unexpected. He really focused on language and how language sort of alienates the human being from itself. Language splits us into conscious and unconscious poles, and Lacan's method of psychoanalysis was to try to help people dialecticize certain traumas that they experienced when they were children that have been linked to words that get sort of lodged in our unconscious. And the process of psychoanalysis, of talking therapy, is to get those words unstuck. Lacan would almost describe language as sort of being etched into our bodies, knotted into the organic connectivity of our bodies, and psychoanalysis is supposed to massage them out of us. So that's Lacan. I read this earlier this summer. For Love of Matter, A Contemporary Panpsychism by Freya Matthews. The idea here is similar to pan-experientialism, though what Freya Matthews was describing in this was the one and the many. The one is the universe as a whole, the cosmos. It has a love for itself, but the one is in loving itself, it divides into many in order to more authentically love itself, as though it were composed of many separate parts. And so all of the many, whether they be atoms, single cells, animals, humans, they have this unquenchable thirst and desire for one another, and that's what drives the whole process of evolution. We have Jean Gebser, a German cultural phenomenologist, I suppose you could call him. This book, The Ever-Present Origin, is in many ways, maybe you could say it's his response to Oswald Spengler's The Decline of the West. Gebser goes through human history and prehistory and describes the evolution of five stages or structures of consciousness. The archaic, the magic, the mythic, the mental, and the integral. And then in the second half of the book, he tells what he expects to unfold in the coming years as the mental structure of consciousness is superseded by the integral. He thinks quantum physics and relativity theory and the eclipsing of mechanism in biology, among other things, that these are signs of the very dualistic, rationalistic mental structure being transformed into the integral structure, where we become, as the title of the book says, aware again of the ever-present origin and are no longer alienated from nature. Gebser's not suggesting that we just reimmerse ourselves in unconsciousness and instinctual submergence in nature. He's suggesting that we, given all of our highly developed intellectual capacities, that we somehow still retain a connection to our source. Very interesting book. Maybe one of the most important books that I think I've ever read, just because of its, the expansiveness of its vision. This is the book On the Taboo Against Knowing Who You Are by Alan Watts. I actually haven't read this summer, I just happened to be in this pile, but this might have been the book that I read in 11th grade in a psychology class that really catapulted my whole path. So I guess if I started anywhere, it was with this book. Bhagavad Gita and its message, translated by Sri Aurobindo. Story of the warrior Arjuna's discussion with Lord Krishna on the battlefield before the war of Kurukshetra. Krishna has to convince him that he must fight because it is his dharma, his duty. The Bhagavad Gita really synthesizes the entire Hindu tradition, Patanjali's Yoga Sutras, the Vedas, the Upanishads, their message is sort of condensed, and Krishna relates it to Arjuna in, I think, 18 chapters. Definitely worth the read. This is The Good Heart, a Buddhist perspective on the teachings of Jesus, given by the Dalai Lama. It's really a transcript of a transcription of a talk, a series of talks that he gave with a group of Christian meditators somewhere in England. Interesting discussion. I mean, the Dalai Lama has a great way of, in this book, describing the differences between Buddhism and Christianity. I mean, the obvious difference is that there is some conception of a transcendent Godhead in Christianity, whereas in Buddhism there is not. It's not exactly an atheistic religion, but it's just, I guess at the end of the day, you'd have to say the Buddha was agnostic about it. He said that is not going to help you. You know, whether there is some God or not, your worship of that God is not going to help you with the basic issue, which is your suffering. So the Buddha didn't really want to say anything one way or the other about it. Though there are similarities between the figure of Jesus Christ and Gautama Buddha, there are also differences there. Buddha was a human being. Christ, Jesus, was a human being, but also divine, so that's a difference. This is The Heart of Matter. It's the spiritual autobiography of the Jesuit paleontologist Pierre Teilhard de Chardin. I always recommend Teilhard to any Christian, devout believer, who is a creationist, who thinks that evolution is untrue, or that if evolution were true, it would destroy their ability, it would destroy their faith. Because Teilhard, being a paleontologist, he of course knew that evolution, that common descent was a fact. And his whole life, for him, at least his philosophical writings, such as, you know, his masterpiece, The Human Phenomenon, it was his struggle to synthesize Christianity with evolution. And by talking about the within of things, which is, as far as he was concerned, science had left out of its account of the evolution of the universe, by talking about the within of things, Teilhard was able to find a place for the love of Christ in the evolution of the universe itself. In a way, he's very similar to Freya Matthews' book, For Love of Matter, A Contemporary Panpsychism, though there are some differences. Freya Matthews is not Christian. There's a definite Christocentrism, you could say, to Teilhard's work. Some people have a problem with that, others don't. I really enjoy his work. This is a series of lectures by Rudolf Steiner about the Gospel according to Luke. It's pretty out there, even for a Christian, I would say. This book I like better than According to Luke. It's another series of lectures by Steiner, Isis, Mary, Sophia, Her Mission and Ours. It's really about the missing feminine component to Christianity that you don't really get from a lot of mainstream traditional Christian teaching. I think that's all I got at the moment. But, that'll give you an idea of the kind of things that I've been reading lately. There's not many science books here. I do enjoy a book on physics once in a while, or I've read a lot of books about biology, evolutionary biology, self-organization, systems theory. But aside from that, it's usually these types of books that I read. So hopefully that is sort of what you were asking for. Thanks for the question, for trying to figure out where I'm coming from. I hope that gives you some insight. Take it easy.